Hi, welcome back to the Inner Sanctum with Freedom Gale. I am so happy to be back here and making a video for you. I have been gone for a little while. I had an apartment previously and my mom moved in with us, and so I allowed her to use my office space, and so I wasn't able to use my computer and video that I had set up there and got busy on other things. Anyhow, today I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the things that I've been learning over the past few years that have to do with the truth about your birth certificate and our social security number. But today I'm specifically going to talk about the truth about our birth certificate and how they came to be. And it really taught me a lot, but I guess I'll save my comments for during the video or after the resource that I share with you. So I came across this article some time ago on the View Zone, and it's called "The Fed Owns You." The Fed owns you, or the federal government owns you. And it has a picture of a baby with a stamp on his forehead. And excuse me, I've been drinking a cold smoothie and my throat is showing it. Anyhow, it talks about how the birth certificates came into being. And the reason that interested me is because my late brother, Chuck, he was a very in-depth student of the Bible and world history and science, math, anything you can think of. And he told me that the Federal Reserve Bank was owned by a few people who pretty much owned the world. And I was like, wow, you know, so I thought I'd do some more research on that. And so I typed in "the federal government owns you," and there popped up this one article. And it's by Gary Vay for the View Zone. Now, this is the best article that I've ever read that explains it in the most simplistic way that I can really understand it. And so I'm not going to try and reinvent the wheel. It's already been done beautifully. So it says, it has a picture of the birth certificate. And it shows the numbers in red. And it has a picture explaining how through the birth certificate system that we have all become enslaved by the United States, pretty much sold our freedom to work and pay taxes to pay back the money that was owed when they became bankrupt, when the country became bankrupt. So I'm going to read a little bit from this article. So it says, it seems that back in 1913 that the United States was short of cash. So by the end of World War I, wartime costs had actually depleted the treasury, and there were several really bad financial panics. The country needed to print more money than it had as equity to restore the confidence in the money supply and get the economy back on its feet. When you or I need more money, we use something as collateral and go to the bank and try and get a loan. When a country needs money, it goes to somewhere also. But in 1913, there wasn't anywhere to go. So the United States created a Federal Reserve Act. This established a private central bank, the Federal Reserve Bank, that would regulate the amount of money the United States was allowed to borrow and put in circulation. It will also expect to be repaid like any other bank with interest. Now, the way my brother, my late brother, explained this to me or us, whoever was there at the time, was that there were a few people, you know, like the Rothschilds, the Morgans, and, you know, that had the Rockefellers that had that were the richest people in the world that had gold in the United States in the Reserve Bank. And that money was printed against, paper money was printed against the amount of gold. And that's how money, paper money first became distributed. It was kind of like, well, we don't have any money. Oh, we have gold, you know? Okay, so what happened is after they printed so much money that equaled the amount of gold that they had in the Federal Reserve Bank, they continued to print more money. And that's how we ended up with a deficit. And as they continue to print more money and more money, well, of course, then the gold loses its value. And we're at the point now where the actual value of the dollar is really nothing at all. It's just paper. So, excuse me, I'm going to go on and read. It says, so the United States created the Federal Reserve Act. And established a private central bank, and so this is where the gold is or was, and that would still be owned by these four men. So whatever happened is that they wanted to be paid back like any bank. This bank that would regulate the amount of money that the United States was allowed to borrow and put into circulation. It would also expect to be repaid like any other bank, with interest. So after only 20 years, things went from bad to worse. During Franklin Roosevelt's term in 1933, the United States was unable to pay back this debt, and the country was bankrupt. The private banks that made up the Federal Reserve demanded their money, and Roosevelt responded. He had to use the only thing left of any value to pay the banks and continue to do business with them. And what he used was the citizens, you and me, of our country, us. So I know you're wondering exactly how they did this. Exactly how all this was orchestrated is too lengthy, the author says here, but this much can be told. The original birth or naturalization record of every U.S. citizen is on file in the official records in Washington, D.C. You can get a copy, and the property and assets of every living citizen is pledged as collateral as national debt. Within 2 weeks and 3 days of each certificate of live birth is to be filed in Washington, D.C. So within 2 weeks of the time you have a baby, you have to file a certificate of live birth in Washington, D.C. And of course, we know we do that at the hospital where they start the process for us. Okay, so it says within 2 weeks and 3 days, each certificate of live birth is to be filed in Washington, D.C. Evidence reveals that there is even a federal children's department established by Shepherd Townsend Act of 1922, and I looked that up, and yes, it's true, under the Department of Commerce that appears to be involved in this process in some way. So every citizen is given a number, the red number on your birth certificate, and each live birth is valued from $650,000 to $750,000 Federal Reserve dollars in collateral from the federal government. I've heard people say that they found out that they were worth millions. So it says this makes you kind of feel a little different when you look at the Federal Reserve, right? So he's showing a picture now of the birth certificate, and I actually ordered mine. As a matter of fact, I forgot to pull it out, but I ordered mine, and it's a little different. But the one that they're showing here is actual deed, a record for valid birth only, and it's printed from the American Bank Note Company. So they're showing here on this life certificate of birth, a number in red, 234-322. And I really urge you to go and look at this article. I don't know how to show it to you from here. So he's showing the picture of the article and that, the birth certificate, and then it's actually printed from a bank. Okay, and it's also in all capital letters. So this is what people are calling today your straw man. So the straw man is a fake you that they've created from using the Social Security numbers and the birth certificate. This is since the early 1960s, state governments have issued birth certificates to persons with legal fictional names using all caps. This is not lawful. This is not a lawful record of your physical birth, but rather an acknowledgement of birth of the juristic all caps names, or the legal all caps name. It may appear to be your true name, but since no proper name is ever written in all caps, either lawfully or grammatically, it does not identify who you are. Okay, so birth certificate is the government's self-created document of who you and I are. The birth certificate is the government's self-created document of title for its new property, you and me. In a way, it makes us kind of a corporation whose company's name is the same as our real name, but written in all caps. This corporation then generates taxes and wealth over its lifetime, and in this way repays the collateral that Uncle Sam borrowed from the Federal Reserve. I really found this really shocking, and as a matter of fact, I continue to study more about it. how they actually came to call it a birth certificate. And he touches on that a little bit down here. And he describes what a bond is. A bond is a surety, an interest-bearing document giving evidence of a debt issued by a government body or corporation. And so this is what that bond thing printed on the bottom of the certificate was. It was actually a bond. And if you go on the website and look at the picture, you'll see that on the bottom. So it's an interest-bearing document giving evidence of a debt issued by a government body or corporation that is sometimes secured by a lien on a property and is often designed to take care of a particular financial need. And that you can find that in Webster's Dictionary. So birth certificates are actually a form of securities called warehouse receipts. The items included on a warehouse receipt, as described in ASS 7-202 of the Uniform Commercial Code, the law which governs commercial paper and transactions which parallel a birth certificate. And this is how they came up with the name, or they're calling it a birth certificate. So the location of the warehouse where the goods are stored, which is the resident. The date of issue of the receipt was the date of the issue. There was a place, a resident, and a date. And then they have next in the bullet point is a consecutive number of the receipt found on the back or front of the certificate, usually in red numbers. It would also, this birth certificate would also include a description of the goods or packages containing them, name, sex, day of birth, etc. The signature also would be the last bullet point they have on the birth certificate would be the signature of the warehouseman, which may be made by his authorized agent, municipal clerk, or state register's signature. And of course, all my brothers and sisters, we all had the same name of this lady. I forget her name right now on our birth certificate. So birth certificates now appear to at least qualify as a warehouse receipts. And they actually got that idea from ships, you know, as they came in into the harbor, you know, the berth, you know, and they called that the berth when the ship would dock. And they would have to fill out a certificate. And so they used that as a means of creating the birth certificate that we've held on to, thinking that we cannot work or we cannot do anything without this, and that it was identity, actual proof of who we are, you know. So I know that when I was younger, my mom had all of our names and birthdays in the Bible, and that's how, before 1930, that all births were recorded in your family Bibles. So it says, once a state has registered a birth document within the United States of Commerce, the department notifies the Treasury Department, uses the loan to purchase a bond. In parentheses, it says, the Fed holds a purchase money security interest in the bond. Okay, so the Treasury uses the loan to purchase a bond from the Department of Commerce. Okay, which invest the sale proceeds in the stock or bond market. Now I'm going to pause and read that part again because it's really important. I shared this article on Facebook. I think only two people read it about 4 years ago. And so I really wanted to break it down and to hope that more people would actually listen to what I'm saying, because I really feel pressed now that all these things are going on in the news. And having been a Bible, you know, scholar and ex-conspiracy theorist, that I almost couldn't sleep at night because I was so worried about, you know, all these conspiracies. And I pulled myself away from that for a while. And I'm not saying I'm going back into it. But what I am saying is that I'm starting to see how these things are really impacting my life and our life today. And so as we continue to watch what's going on in the news, we're not really paying attention to the things that we need to be aware of. Okay, so Wag the Dog was a movie we watched a few years ago, probably about 10, 15 years ago. And it talked about, and it was a true documentary. I can't remember. I think it was Reagan in office at that time. But I have to go back and look it up. I want to watch it again, actually, because what it showed was how the media, which is also owned by a few people, you know, that have wealth in the world, and how they are, you know, kind of monopolize the news and only show us what they want us to see and how they actually make up stories. It's called Wag the Dog. And they make up stories in the news, like war, a big war over here, or, you know, something even more outrageous than that. and they keep us focused on that fake story so that we won't look and see what's really going on at the time, you know. And so that was also very, you know, just shake my head kind of nonsense. I really couldn't believe that we have been party to. You know, so I'll come back to that. But what I really was thinking to say was, while we're so worried about racism, and this is also a ruse, I believe, that they're using now to keep us defocused on what we really need to be focused on. I don't think it's a coincidence that this is a corporation, or the United States, you know, is a corporation. It's a country, but it's very commercialized. And so it's a corporation. And Donald Trump is a businessman, you know, and he doesn't pay taxes because he knows all these things. He knows that he doesn't have to. But we do. We are actually slaves, you know, in this country. You know, we won't be able to free ourselves until we redeem, you know, ourselves out of this system, till we get from underneath this system. And it is possible. And I'll talk more about that later, or perhaps in another video. So this one won't be too long. So it says, let me go back. Okay, it says the Treasury uses the loan to purchase a bond. And we talked about what that was. Okay, from the Department of Commerce, which then the Department of Commerce invests the sale proceeds in the stock market. Okay, so once a state has registered a birth document with the United States Department of Commerce, who would think it's going to a Department of Commerce? The department then notifies the Treasury Department, the department, the U.S. Department of Commerce notifies the Treasury Department, which then takes out a loan from the Federal Reserve Bank. Okay, now they're taking out a loan on your name, on your birth, your poor little innocent baby, and your mom was taught that she had to do this, right? I did it with my children. The Treasury uses the loan to purchase a bond from the Department of Commerce, okay, which invests the sale proceeds, okay, which invests the proceeds of the sale in the stock market or a bond. Now, I know people who, if you look up some YouTube videos, they'll say they actually traced that number and found, you know, their actual number on the stock market and found out how much they were worth. And I guess it goes according to where you were born, what city and state, and how much that they were guaranteeing at the time. So the Treasury Department then issues Treasury securities in the form of Treasury bonds, notes, and bills, using the bonds as surety for the new securities. Okay, this cycle is based on future tax revenues of the legal person whose name appears on the birth certificate. Again, it says this cycle is based on the future tax revenues of the legal person whose name appears on the birth certificate. This also means that the bankrupt corporate United States can guarantee to the purchasers of their securities the lifetime labor and tax revenues of every citizen of the United States / America with a birth certificate as collateral for payment. I don't really feel like I need to say anything else. You should be shocked the same way I was. And I think I even left it alone for a while because I was just like, needed to process it, you know, and continued. When I did dabble back in it here and there, I came up again with ways that we can actually free ourselves from the system. One is sovereignty, and another one is acceptance for value. I'm still not sure if you have to become sovereign in order to do acceptance for value. And acceptance for value is a formula or a form or a way of redeeming that money to use to pay your bills with. And I want to actually start a home study group so that I can start learning more about this and actually learning how to implement it in my life. and helping other people implement it so that we can become free, you know, and I'm sure that's the dream of every human being, you know, boy or girl, whether you're sick or maimed and you want to be free from that, or whether you're just financially strapped or whatever it is that you want to be free from, emotional pain, you know. So here we go. So I want you to take some time to look up this article and read it. Okay, so it says that this means that the bankrupt corporation or United States can guarantee to the purchasers of their securities lifetime labor and tax revenues of every citizen in the United States of America with a birth certificate as collateral for payment. Okay, and it says this device is initiated simply by converting the lawful true name of the child into a legal juristic name of a person. And what they do is they just use all capital letters. Now, if you notice in the mail, if you own a mortgage, or a lot of your mail will come in all caps. And so acceptance for value shows you how to separate yourself from that, what they call the fake person, or the legalistic, or the juristic, or, you know, legal person, juristic name of who I am, Vivian Gale, born, you know, is not really me. So when I write my name, I write it with a capital V, all small letters, and then a capital for my last name, and then small letters. So legally, we are considered to be a slave or indentured servants to various federal, state, and local governments via our state-issued, state-created birth certificates or bonds in the name of our all-cap person. Birth certificates are issued so that the issuer can claim exclusive title to the legal person created thereby. Now, there's so much information on YouTube, and I'm so grateful that YouTube is an open source of information that is not able to be manipulated by these moguls that own all the media. There's like five, you know, media moguls. I studied broadcast journalism for a while, and I learned that, you know, that there was a few men that owned all, or a few men, I think they're all men, five, all, they own all media, all television, and all radio stations. You know, so, and most of the magazines. So anything that we hear is going to come from what they allow. They only allow the reporters to cover certain topics, and they won't allow independent press or independent stories such as this one to be displayed. So every now and then one breaks through, you know, and it's refreshing, and it causes people to search for more information. So I'm asking, you know, and I'm trying to reach as many minorities as I can, my family, my friends, and hoping that you do listen, you know, to my voice. And if you don't believe me, then look up this information for yourself. Again, this article I got from the internet, and it's still up here. It's been up here for a few years. It's called Surprise, the Fed Owns You. And it's from theviewzone.com. And it looks like it's the only article here that they have, which is okay for me. I don't want to rewrite it. He did a great job, but I did want to share it with you today. So stay tuned for more. I want to talk about the Social Security card and sovereignty and acceptance for value, and how we can learn how to no more be slaves. And please, I urge you to don't spend time hating and rioting and, you know, picketing. Let's all try and work towards peace, a peaceful environment, a peaceful state of mind, and use wisdom and gather knowledge, because we're going to need it. You know, the time is approaching soon where this is all really going to matter. If you don't have control, you know, and the dollar falls, and you can lose everything all over again. The stock market will crash. You can lose all the money you have saved in the bank. You can lose your 401k plans, you know, and unless you receive this, it's going to go into a cashless society, because money's not going to be worth anything. And that's when the Bible comes in Revelation 13 through 16. It talks about the mark of the beast and how we're not going to be able to buy or sell unless we have a chip. You know, which is a number of a man whose name is 666. Yeah, I know all about that. That's a whole nother video series, but I'm sure you all have heard about it a bit. Stay tuned if you live in my Washington, King County area. I'll be starting a small group to study these things. You can look me up on my website. I'm Vivian Gale of Freedom, and viviangale.com. And stay tuned for more. Peace and blessings.